So bom dia, third class in our course, short course here at LaMaV. Today we have insulation wind power, so we will talk about glass fiber technology, what type of fibers we have, how they are produced, what are their properties, and then what for they are used for reinforcement, and therefore the wind power application, and then also, of course, not only for the fibers for reinforcement, we have, of course, insulation properties. So all the wools which are produced worldwide go into insulation segment for houses, for industrial applications. So we'll see about that. And then at the end, we'll have a short thing on a little bit on, as last time, we'll have a look in current research on fibers, for instance, to understand what's going on in fibers, okay? That's the plan for today, okay. So we'll start with the glass fiber technology. So insulation, glass fiber technology. Okay, we can divide the fibers into two classes, continuous and discontinuous fibers. So the ones which have definite lengths and those which can be drawn by kilometers and so on. So from the filament forming perspective, we can divide the fibers in spinnable fibers and non-spinnable fibers. From the spinnable fibers, you make bundles, you make a yarn, you can make some textures, textiles, things like that. And we see that this will go into the reinforcement sector. On the other side, the non-spinnable fibers are wools, and these wools are pressed, are formed, are cutted into mats, like here, for insulation of domestic applications, industrial applications, and so on. Though these are the two general things we have on one side, forming of the filament, in direction of a fiber, spinnable, yarns, textiles, things like that. And on the other side, non-spinnable fibers, though they have short lengths, 10, 20 centimeters, something like that, okay? Okay, some properties on both here, continuous filament, wool, you see that the sizes are, we cannot say that this is pretty much different, no, but the wools are a little bit thinner than the continuous fibers. Normally, we'll see some spectra, some distribution of their diameters in a short. We'll see that the fibers, of course, in the first case, continuous filament, they are, of course, parallel oriented or in some way woven to yarn or something like that, always paralleled, and they are, if they have to cut, they are cut it in the downstream action. On the other side, we have these wools, and these wools are the fibers, the filaments are oriented somewhere when it is not a straight texture inside that, okay? We see different types of glass. We'll come to this nomenclature. What is S glass, R glass, E glass, D glass, whatever. They are named by their application and by their properties. And that is on one side. On the other side, if we talk on wools, we'll make it, we will have to distinct between stone wools and glass wools. Glass wools are made of recycling colors and is a soda lime silica glass, basically. On the other side, the stone wools, they are made out of minerals, raw materials, diopsides, basalts, things like that, and they're melted in a cupola type of furnace, reducing atmospheres with carbon, and these are alumosilicate glasses. alkaline earth alumosilicate glasses. So you see clearly that there's, of course, a difference in the structure, and you will see that's a difference in TG, that's a difference in the thermal expansion coefficient, a difference in the thermal properties of these fibers. So the stone wool fibers are going more into high temperature insulation. The glass wool normally you have in domestic applications where the temperature is not so high. So that's one of the differences. Okay, I think that's pretty much okay here for this short introduction to compare these two types of fibers. Okay, now we come to these continuous fibers and their names, and you see that the letters give some hint to what for, what are the properties. The E-glass is originally designed to have a very low thermal conductivity, so electrical purpose was behind. So that's E-glass, S for strength, C for chemical durability, and M, high stiffness, A, alkali, and D, low dielectric constant. We'll see the different type of glasses here, and one of the most produced are the so-called E-glass, and you see from the composition the E-glass is an alumo borosilicate glass, so we have from the network formers all three inside, silica, alumina, and the boron, and there's enough alkaline earth ions here to excess, to build an excess. So aluminum is in the tetrahedral position, and we have a closed network structure, same with the boron, so we have a lot of that to compensate or to foster the tetrahedral position of boron and of aluminum in these materials. Okay, then we have the same E-glass without boron. This is a difference in the viscosity temperature. The with boron, you know, it gets viscosity down. It's much easier a little bit to produce. And we'll see it depends on the liquidus to a certain fiberization temperature. This is the fiberization viscosity range. And we'll have to have, to make a fiberization, these both properties, so the temperature at which the fiber can be fiberized between 2 points, viscosity, Pascal second, logarithm of that, 2.6 to 1.5 logarithm. So it's between 30 and 500 Pascal seconds. We'll have in a while. Well, that's the fiberization range in viscosity. And it's now important if we are above at that viscosity, these temperatures above liquidus or below liquidus. If we are below liquidus, then of course during fiberization crystallization happens. And that's then always a risk, and they don't want to take that. And by that, chemical composition has changed a little bit, fiberization properties are changed a little bit to have not this risk of crystallization. Okay, then we have here ECR glass, alumino lime silicate glass. It's also here given, so it's practically silica glass. You see lime, silica, and then we have aluminum, and then we have the high strength glasses, which is an alumosilicate glass, where the aluminum is stabilized in the tetravalent, in the tetrahedral position with magnesia, and also the R glass, where we have calcium and magnesia as well. And of course, there are silica glass fibers for optical application. We'll not cover here optical applications from silica glass fibers. Well, that goes into telecommunication and things like that. We don't talk today about that. Okay, so these are these glass fiber types, how they are produced. Okay, here's the, you see a schematic drawing on how these glasses are produced. We start, of course, has to see we have a need in raw materials, different kind of sources of raw materials. We need some source for alumina. We need some source for the silica, for the boron, for magnesia, for calcium. And you run here with the normal or the standard raw materials. You make a batch, and you bring in the batch in a tank, in a furnace, and you produce your glass there. You melt it. You have a batch to melt conversion. You're melting down the batch, and then there's refining going on, and then we see here, and that's now what is the difference to the normal production of bottles or flat glasses or things like that. We have now forming, and this forming goes through so-called bushings, and these bushings are plates made of platinum, and in these plates are holes. So these are like, oops, no, not working, not really. And they have, you have a lot of these holes inside. Oh, sorry. And so on. And then through all of these holes, one fiber is flowing down, and you see that gives a lot of fibers, and then it depends what is here. If there's a drum or like this gathering shoe, which brings all these filaments together, and then you have different ways how to wind up this here the to build a coil of that, and you see that is different types of winders. Here with a traversal, you go one like this and then like that, or you can chop it, and then you have short types of fibers from this continuous filament build up. At the end, you produce something like that, what goes then into reinforcement structures. Okay. So here's some images how that produced. You see that there are a lot of these fiberization stations here, and you can see here what is built up. It's like you're having on each of these there's built. Oh, sorry. Opa. Maybe it's like that. You have a certain drawing stress. And with that drawing stress, it's produced like an onion type shaped glass here at the nozzle. At the nozzle. And then here it goes maybe up to winding up, or it is like a collector coming here to bring all these together. Okay, but you have a drawing force here. I will clean up a little bit here. Ah, they had also cut the 15s, yes. Okay. Okay, now we are a little bit more. Okay, so that's what happens here. And so it depends, of course, on the temperature. The temperature tells us which viscosity we have for a certain composition. So to get this fiberization action, this drawing action, the viscosity has to have a certain values. It has to have not too low, not too high for this kind of fiberization process. No, well, this is given here. Okay, now we come to this. Though what is of interest is the relation between this fiberization viscosity, the temperature at which that happens, and the liquidus temperature. This opens a window, a fiberization window. And there are some examples given here. So they have an upper and a lower value for fiberization. The lower value is log viscosity in Pascal seconds, 1.5. it's about, what is this, 30 Pascal seconds. And the upper is here, is 2.6, 2.7, about 500 Pascal seconds. Inside that window, that's your question, fibrization can be done. This is, has to do something with the cohesive forces and with the surface tension under these drawing forces that, that the fiber can be formed. Okay, on the other side, we have the temperature axis. This is normalized here, Tg over T, like we have in the standard angel plot or, yeah, so it's normalized to Tg to bring, or relative to Gg to bring everything together. And you see here different kinds of glasses, like a silica glass fiber down to a diopside fiber. And you see that the window becomes smaller and smaller and smaller because the liquidus temperature is always given with a star here. You see that's the star. And here it's up, but here it's limited, of course, to the upper viscosity range. So we have for these compositions, like for the silica, you have a broad window how where to fiberize this. But if you go into this direction, it becomes smaller and smaller and smaller, and even for the basalt fibers, these basalt fibers are very, very, you have a very small production window. No? Otherwise, if you going down here, this is the same. You see, here's liquidus temperature over the temperature at a certain Pascal value. Here's 1,000 poise. 1,000 poise is 100 Pascal second. 100 Pascal second is 10 to the power 2. Okay, so that's here. That's like a mean value. This mean value is the green line here. And you see a lower and the upper value here with these dashed lines. So inside that, if you're above this line, you're having taking no risk of crystallization on these bushings here or bushings. But if you're going to this corner here, then crystallization can happen. And you see now the different CE, R glass, S glass up there, and the basalt glass, as we have talked here, the basalt is becoming a little bit under this line, so this is critical, or it is hard to make basalt glass fibers. If we are below here, we will see with the wools, we are here, so with the wools, we cannot draw a continuous fiber because of the composition, the stone wools, for instance, so they are produced in a cascade process, and you have short fiber filaments, and then these are collected and build up the wool for insulation power. So these are the glasses which you make a continuous fiber, and on that range you are very limited to your forming of your filament. There are only cascade processes or something like that works, and there you have a fiber for maybe that length or so.
Is this a reason why we have thinner fibers or wools and thicker if we have continuous fiber? The fact that we cannot make...
Yes, one of the thing is, of course, that we increase temperature, and if we increase temperature, we'll get to thinner fibers then to come a little bit to get a little bit of production window, and we got thinner fibers for that at higher temperatures produced to take not the risk of TL of the liquidus temperature crystallization if we go below this. And also by this cascade, there's a lot of forces action. Thinner fibers are having a higher fictive temperature than a lower volume, specific volume, higher specific volume, lower specific density. For the wools, they are so-called hyperquench, we'll see in a bit, then continuous fibers. Okay? Okay, so now comes to the applications. Why reinforcement? Reinforcement, of course, first is the reinforcement, a thing of mechanical, so of the strength, But in sometimes, or not sometimes, but with if you reinforce with glasses, you get you add other features as well. Of course, the glasses are not cannot be burned. They have fire resistance, for instance. So you're getting some fire resistance, and they are like produced like curtains in big factories, dividing segments, and if there's a fire alarm, these curtains come down and they are produced of a glass fiber, special glass fiber type texture, textile structure to protect that the fire comes from one part of the big hall to another part or things like that. So this is one of the indoor applications. And this is, of course, a reinforcement inside these textile fibers, but with the application of high strength. Then with the chemical resistance, electrical properties, of course, our glasses are dielectric materials, and then this, and of course, up to here, a dimensional stability can be given by the use of glass fibers in mats, in some layered structure. Okay, so coming to the strengths aspect, this is one of the most, or the one which is first you think of, a reinforcement. And here you see the tensile strain versus tensile stress, so a stress strain diagram and typical values for fibers. We have the E-glass fiber, the S-glass fiber, then we have aramid, like a protection fiber. Kevlar is one of the trademarks of these fibers. And then we have a intermediate modulus carbon fiber and a high-strength carbon fiber here. And you see, of course, that the carbon fibers have a higher Young's modulus. They are stiffer. It's much steeper as the glass fibers. And by that, it's, of course, if you think on the E-modulus and on the stiffness of your construction, carbon fibers are the first choice, of course. And if you think on the difference in the density, the glass fiber 2.5, a carbon fiber 1.75. So you have higher strengths, a stiffer material, and it is not so heavy. So it's lighter. So by that you can make bigger constructions, taller constructions, and so this is used, of course, all these carbon fibers, you know these are used now to make aeroplanes like the Dreamliner. They are just made out of carbon fiber reinforced polymer structures. And now comes the other thing. If we go to the applications we are hitting for, environment, energy applications, the carbon fiber is much too expensive. And you see the cost factor here, E-glass fiber 1, carbon fiber 30. So it's 30 times more costly than a glass fiber. And now think of people who are competitive in the area to get a sector in the environmental, in the energy sector, and you have to compete about fossil energy produced by gas, by oil, and so on, by coal. So that has to be very cheap. Besides, you already need subsidies from governments or so to implement, like wind turbines, things like that. So by that, it has to be a cheap material, okay? So in most of the structures, the carbon fiber is just used on very strategic points where we need more stiffness, where we need this, but not on the full rotor blade. So most of the material is there still a glass fiber, E-glass fiber, S-glass fiber, S2 or whatever, no? Because it's much cheaper than the carbon fiber. Okay, now come to the wind power application. You see that these wind turbines become larger and larger and larger and larger. Right now, we are the world record, I think, is on rotor blades up to 85 meters, one side, and then you have to think on the other side, another 85 meters. This is something like here, given, so that's the size where the wind turbines are today. So this is the altitude, the silhouette of the Cathedral of Cologne. If you ever have been in Germany, it's a very huge building, and this is more than this size now on that big hill. So it's about up to 150 meters something to 180 meters. So we are here somewhere standing. And why they're getting bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger? And that's of course one of the laws, that the power which is produced is proportional to the area of these rotor, though to the length of a rotor, if you want to have by squared, so proportional to the area. So as bigger, you produce more, or you can produce more power. So they need very tall, very light construction, but they have to have a certain stiffness. They have to have these mechanical properties to ensure that under a certain wind velocity, the rotor can take that before it is pitched. Pitch means it is tilt at the maximum velocity, and then otherwise it will risk of breaking the rotor, though there's a tilt inside. You will see in the next transparency and by that to ensure high or the service at very high rotations and very high loads of wind in these wind turbines. So this is a clear development, and you see it's not so, it's a very young industry, started in the 80s maybe, and now we're 35 years later, we have constructions larger than cathedrals. And of course with that, we always have the debate, do we need that? No one wants to have such a colossus, such a monster in his garden, because you get it makes a shadow, like with every rotation, if the sun is shining, something like that. And this is always like black, white, you see. And then people are blaming about that, of course. If you have like a wind park in front of a village with 150 meters high of these things, then this is, there has to be certain concepts where to bring it, and this is useful to bring it everywhere and things. We'll see in a bit. Okay, good, how to make these fibers? You see that these are very tall, very long constructions. They have a certain, very important for the turbine is the aerodynamic of the rotor blade. There you can win the most of the efficiency of the whole system. And so this has to be designed very, very well. And then you see that this is made like in a sandwich type of construction. You have half shells down and up, and then you have these spars in between, like in the construction of an aeroplane, you know. And though the materials which are used, glass fiber preforms, so mats, textiles of glass fibers, will have the white one here, E-glass, S-glass, or ECR glass. This is the E-glass with more chemical resistance. Or on strategic points, you see the black ones here inside. This is carbon fiber, though this is a mixture. The bright ones here are the glass fibers, and the others are the carbon fibers. And that is now brought into lamination action or production, we'll see, to build up these wings. So, though they need to have a very huge long haul, 85 meters is one rotor already, and you see here some of these images from the construction companies here, and then there are different methods to do it. One of the methods, the pre-prac methods, but one is the I want to introduce you here, is the vacuum-assisted resin infusion technique. And you see that this is practically given in six steps. Where we make a half shell. We prepare this half shell mold first here. And then there comes in these textiles we saw from the glass fibers before, last transparency. And then the key part is then a infiltration of the resin under vacuum. So you pump a vacuum on one side and by that let the resin flow in and so that it covers all the structural details inside and by that makes a good composite of our glass fiber and of our polymer here. That is built up here, so we have this molding. Then we have the infusion technique, infiltration under vacuum. Then it has to be cured. And after curing, you can assemble then the two half shells with the spars in between to build up some of these rotors. So that's the techniques they have developed for. Then you see here some of these infiltration of this infusion technique under vacuum in this very huge long hall here. Okay, so a wind turbine is well, we talked about this glass construction here. Now something to the efficiency, and you see the efficiency of all efficiency of a wind turbine is determined by three things: the rotor blade aerodynamics, 0.4. Efficiency, roughly, very roughly. Then we have the gearbox. Of course, we have a gearbox. And this gearbox, maybe there we have some wear and friction and things like that. So it's 0.95. Generally, they are just tooth wheels which are taken inside, so it's not so big loss here. And then we have a generator, and if it's an electric generator, well, if it's a good one, around 0.9. So at the end, if we bring in the efficiency, we are at 0.34. Okay, for that. Well, that's what more or less the thing which we have in most of the energy conversion systems. We never have 100%. Of course, if you run a certain type of fuel cells, you are theoretically up to 90%, things like that. But in real practice, you're always below on that. Okay. Okay. But now comes the power which goes in. So this is what is the efficiency factors here. And what comes in is, of course, if you think of the kinetic energy, it's always the kinetic energy U, it's always 1/2, and then we have the mass and the velocity of a square. No? That's normal. But now the wind is coming to the system and blowing with a certain velocity, so the power has to have the wind on that side, and by that will come up here with the cube. So that's the P in the wind turbines. Yeah? Okay, so it depends on the velocity or the mean velocity of the wind which is blowing. And by that it should be a cubed dependence on the power which is blowing. And that you see here. Here's the wind speed over the power, and you see that this is going up very with this cube dependence here. Of course, you can imagine it goes up here and then more and more of these losses, or it depends on the wind speed. And then we have a certain maximum where the rotors are turned. And by that, this is controlled. So if there's a bow, if there's a very hard wind, they control the pitch of the rotors and by that feather. So they always work on the maximum they can take here. This is for this wind turbine up to 2,050 kilowatts. Okay? That's always if the wind is blowing constant at least 11.2 meters per second. Of course, you can think it's not always blowing like that. It's blowing sometimes harder than it's feathered by the pitch. But if it's not blowing, we are below here. Okay? And these then are averages taken here. The red curve is the average P average versus speed average, because P is a function of the time and the wind is not always blowing, although the wind speed is a function of time. Okay, that these curves, and with these curves they calculate and design wind parks and things like that. Okay, good. So how is the wind is blowing, and that wind blows gives you the capacity factors. The capacity factor is now the ratio between the actual mean power and the maximum mean power. That means the wind is blowing always harder, faster than 11.2 meters per second. Then we have always at full power, okay? But it's not the case. And you see some of these monthly capacity factors for selected fuel technologies. You see the wind here around 30 to 40% at that spot where it is located. So if you design such a thing, you have always to look where is the wind blowing, mostly constantly, where you have continuously wind, or only just a few times very hard, so that's not very fair. Like you are talking, or like it is in the solar business, we have to go to the sun belt of the earth, where the irradiation of the sun is much more higher than somewhere in the north or in the south, where we have a lot of clouds and things like that. And by that, the efficiency of a photovoltaic is not, or the time to produce the same amount of electrical energy is much longer, like in Germany, like it would be as if it were in the Sahara or the northeast of Brazil or somewhere. Okay, same for the wind. Of course, if you are of your you see, nuclear power, of course, you can run always. Of course, you have your cycle. Geothermal, it's always constant. The Earth is warm down there. There is no day-night or something. and so on and so on. Okay, and you see down here. So that's what you have to consider, you have to think of. Okay, now to the wind sector, and there are a lot of these diagrams here. First of all, on the left-hand side, this is the current December 2000, the most recent data on the cumulative capacity, so that's the sum which is installed per country, and you see the red one is the People's Republic of China. The largest capacity of wind turbines is installed in China. Okay. Then comes here the US. And then you see it's Germany, India, Brazil. It's here, this segment already. Okay, this is increasing. Yeah, they build a lot in Brazil. Now you see the current development, what has been done in the last year. So that's the numbers, how much comes new installed. So the new installed capacity you see growing most is China. You see half of the cake. And then you see here Turkey, United Kingdom, France, India, Brazil. So Brazil is taking more and more, or using more and more wind power in that segment. So, and that in the current development, okay. Okay, so who is producing the wind turbines, the rotor blades, and you see also here the development, the technology started, I think, in Denmark and in Germany, and now Chinese companies are taking over. Of course, there's GE from the States, General Electric, but you see this is a, this one, this, they're all Chinese companies taking larger segments or chairs on the global market. And then there's GE from the States, and Vestas was former the largest one from Denmark. No? Okay, and then there are German Siemens, Enercon, they are the largest German, and then there's a Spanish one. These are the global producers. So it's four or five countries which produce wind turbine in a large share on the global market. Okay, here you see what are the costs of these turbines and what is the cost of the rotor blades where the glass fibers are in, and you see the rotor blades, turbine blades here, blue, 10%. So the whole construction, the turbine blades are only 10%. You see a lot, the tower costs the same like the blades, the generator costs the same, the gearbox costs the same. You see here the fractions of all these factors which are you have to think of these component costs for a wind turbine. Okay, so it's not the ultimate cost factor is turbine blades, so it's only 10% of the total. And the glass fibers are only a percentage of that, of course. Okay, where the wind is blowing? Then two things to show you here. First, in the States, you see the wind atlas, and you see that there are some so-called windy states. They are in the center here from, I don't know, Iowa in the north to Texas in the south. And you see here on the side where the wind capacities are installed. And you see, of course, it doesn't make sense to do this in Florida or here at the Atlantic coast or on the other side in Arizona, wherever, because there's wind not blowing. So the most of these turbines are produced onshore in the US, onshore in the windy states here down here. Okay, so you see Iowa here in Texas. Okay, in Brazil it's the northeast and it's mostly offshore, the new installations. So then Germany, very little tiny country. You see where's the wind blowing? Inside the country, not at all or not that much. It's just blowing on the coast, on the North Sea coast. So the directives and all the thing where the wind chairs are in Germany has to come, it will be offshore. So they're producing large wind parks here in the North Sea segment. The North Sea is divided by all the countries, and there's only one small slice which belongs to Germany, and this will be in the future full of wind turbines. Okay, again in Germany, renewable energies total energy consumption about 12%. For electricity, want to get 18%. In electricity, you are hydroelectricity, 80% Brazil. Yeah, totally different thing. And then you see wind power. Here is one of the things, but it is increasing. As I said, the first offshore installations are now coming to the grid. And by that, in December, this was the last, in December, the energy produced by wind was more than by lignite. Lignite is a soft coal for firing. We have in Germany soft coal deposits, the brown coal, lignite. And so that was the news here in that. So the windy seasons are winter, and you see December here. Okay. So what is prognosed for Germany? They want to go to offshore wind parks, higher capacity factor, the wind is blowing more constant at higher speeds. You can have larger rotor areas offshore than onshore. And that's one of the most thing which in Germany debate on public participation. So people don't want to have these huge towers in front of in their garden, near to their village, wherever. So they said, okay, we'll bring that offshore there only the seagulls see this, or the, I don't know, the animals, whatever. But you see that it's very ambivalent. On one side, people who are concerned about the environment, they want to foster these type of energies. On the other side, to say, oh, if we have these wind turbines, then animals and the living is not the social aspect, you know, the living is not as convenient because you always have these shadows, these frequent shadows, you're getting mad in your brain or whatever, things like that. So there are a lot of people fighting who don't want any more wind parks besides cities or so. Because there's a lot already in Germany installed, as you have seen. For the small country, you have seen here on the shares, it's a lot for this small country, okay? Okay, we're coming back. So that's the plan for Germany. Here you see Chancellor Merkel with the helicopter over the new installed offshore. So these are these offshore North Sea wind farms. And you see this is the slice of the North Sea which belongs to Germany. And the yellow parts will be all given to wind parks. This is a lot, yes. And already, and this is the old numbers, in Germany, well, is it only this little slide here? It is most from the other European countries, the biggest, the largest shares of this wind park. So Germany, of course, it has companies, as you have seen, they are producing the thing. So it's also economic factor in Germany. To getting this wind turbine technology more developed. And now they are one with the Danish Vestas company, leading companies for offshore wind parks and so on. Okay. So that's what they have for Germany. And now comes the glass fiber people and said, okay, if you're going offshore, you need other type of glass fibers. And this is a recent prospect here, brochure from 3B fiberglass. And they said, as you can read here, corrosion resistance, a solution for offshore blades. And they said, okay, their name is Advantix, but it's an ECR glass. Or it's an E-glass with higher chemical resistance. Okay. So that's, now we have, we are back to the glass fibers. Okay, so that's what is produced. And this company, I think, is coming from Belgium or so. Okay, so this was continuous reinforcement wind power. Now to wools. Okay, the wools can be divided into ceramic wools, mineral wools. The mineral wools are stone wool, glass wool, and slag wool. You already see where it's made from. The stone wool is made from a natural mineral. The glass wool is made from glass cullets, broken recycled glass. And the slag wool is made out of slags, which comes from industry. Okay, though these are the man-made fibers. Of course, they are natural fibers and man-made fibers. Natural fibers like asbestos, things like that, which they also used in the 50s and 60s for reinforcement. But you know that the dissolution rates of asbestos in your lung very, very long, and so they are cancerogenic. The fibers which are produced today have very short dissolution, short dissolution times, fast dissolution rates, relatively fast, though there's no risk of getting cancer by inhaling these short fiber segments. Of course, if you have insulation, and this is given here, insulation wools, which are made before 95, they're cancerogenic because at that time, the composition was in that direction that the dissolution rates in the pH milieu in your lung, in your areoles, now here's the lung, areoles, though the dissolution rates are too slow it is too long, and by that it can provoke, it can cancer. So all, if there is a house, you get an old house and you want to renew it, you refurnish it, and you see old insulation material first, like in Europe, I don't know how it's in Brazil, you have to test what type of fibers they are, and if they are the old type of fibers, all the people come in the full dress, you know, with all that, and then they bringing that out, or if it's a new one, you have not. And then by that, also the craftsmen can work today with that, without a very hard protection. Of course, they have a mask, but okay. So that's something to the wools, and you see here the composition: so slack wool, mineral wool, also called rock wool. But rock wool is also a company name, one of the largest producer from Denmark. Producing mineral wools globally. And then you have a glass wool. And you see the glass wool, this is 63.14, and then we have the magnesium about 3, and we have a little bit boron inside, but this is practically a composition like a soda lime silica glass with less lime or no, it's always the same, 3 to 10. It's 10, 14, and here 64. It's the soda lime silica glass. This is the glass wool. Okay, the rock wools are different. They are alumosilicates. Now we have, and they are alkaline earth, 16 to 30% calcium oxide, and the slags as well. So if we go to a ternary diagram as shown here, we have the network formers, and I always count alumina to, as a network firmer. Of course, you know, if you take alumina alone, you will not make a glass, or it's very, very, very hard. People try a lot by levitation, high temperatures, things like that. I'm not sure if that has been clear now, if that's possible. For my interpretation, you always need something, a second oxide, that this becomes a network former. Okay, so we'll bring them up here, and yes, and on this side we have the alkalis, and on this side, of course, barium oxide is added, but here is calcium, magnesium. And then you see that we come from the glass wool to rock wools to slag wools, mineral wools to slag wools here, and we are running more in this caustic region, calcium and magnesium oxide. Okay. And by that, we're changing properties. Expansion coefficient, high, lower, 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 if we go in this direction. TG, low, higher, 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 and so on. So this also then for the applications, low temperature insulation applications, high temperature insulation applications. Okay, an overview of the three production of the wool production. Three methods. This is only for microfibers. We'll just go very quick to this, but these are the most important in case of the insulation. So we have the rotary and cascade spinners, and you see the throughput very high in this case. You see the fiber diameters 1.5, 8, 3 to 10. High energy, low energy, this is the one which is used for the mineral fibers, the other, the cascade, rotary is used for the glass fibers. This is used for microfibers. You use marbles or glass spheres which you have melted before, and these are in this pot, is reheated, and then there's a bushing, and then it rolls through these rollers here, and then there's a burner, and by the burner gives force to this glass line here, and by that chop it into short segments and very thin glass fibers, so you make micro glass fleece, things like that, fabrics, mats out of that. But this is something special. These are the two common production for the on the left hand side for the glass wools, in the center for the mineral stone wool production. Yes. Okay, once again, this slide, which I've stolen by Mr. Lead here, fiberglass processing, and you see that for the mineral wools cascade, we are down to that region, and by that we are very limited to our fiberization process, so we can just make discontinuous fibers, but not a continuous fiber. In this way, the temperatures, the liquidus temperatures are much higher here, and by that we have to go to higher temperatures, and we are below this line here. Okay. Good. Here are the properties of that wools, and one of the property, or one, first of all, of course, fiber diameters is a continuous filament, and here these are fibers cascade rotary, or the microfibers, very thin diameters. So you see with the diameter, you get to thinner and thinner, and by that you are quenching your material much harder, faster and faster. So by that you store a lot of energy inside. Though these cascade or rotary glass fibers are fibers which are having a high fictive temperature. The fictive temperature is about 200 K up to 200 K above glass transition temperature. And we talked last time about fictive temperature and the effects which fictive temperatures have. We will see a little bit that this has also an effect on the fibers. You normally test that by a standardized method, as is shown here. You're measuring the heat capacity. You can measure also in your lab. You have in your DC here. And you will get probably a new one to measure more precisely heat capacity. But if you do that and you get the fiber, you heat it up the first time, you don't know the thermal history. The fiber is quenched. Now we heat it up with 10K or 20K per minute. What we normally see is something, it's going down and then it comes up. Looks like that. This is your glass transition from the heat capacity. Okay. This is the temperature, and here we have the heat capacity, Cp. Okay. Then you cool the fiber with 10K per minute. Now you freeze in the fiber under a standard cooling rate. Before it was frozen in under 10 to the power 4, 10 to the power 5 Kelvin per second. And now you heat it up, and if you heat it now up, you're getting something like that, which is something like that, and you're changing up here, oh, sorry, a bit like that, okay. So you produce here, that what is here, this is the excess enthalpy, and this is the potential energy which is stored inside this fiber. The fiber has a different structure. As we have seen, the angles of that network is a little bit different. It's more open structure, less dense if it's a normal glass. And this energy is stored in the fiber. And then you can figure out by a certain method, and this is given here, the fictive temperature, though you have to set equal the areas, the area of this to the area here, which is, or make it like that. And where this area meets this area, this is your fictive temperature. So fictive temperature, delta H is zero by definition. This is a fictive temperature definition. And so you have to measure, if you want to measure fictive temperatures, the fictive temperature is related to the cooling rate of your system. Okay, so you see here TG, which is in the standard heating up second run here, it's 941 and the fictive temperature 1155, so around 200 K for these fibers. Okay. Okay, so these are the processes for these fibers, glass wool production. You see these are these rotary spinners. So we have the melting of cullets on the recycled glass. And then will have a melt stream, and this melt stream is bring into a rotator. It looks like your washing machine. It's like an open pot with a lot of, on the walls, with a lot of holes. And due to the centrifugal forces, the glass melt is pressed through the holes, building up filaments. And then there are burners here around to heating this up. And then there is a like a stream going down. And then there is binder is sprayed on the surface of the fiber to make them connect together. This is the yellow color. And by that, you can form later on a mat, which is cut it or so. Okay, here the process. So this is the melter, the forearms. Here the rotary fiberization. Then there's a collecting box. Here's air sucked that the fibers come down to this collecting box. This is like rotating, and so it's increasing the value or the mass of these fibers on this. This is always rotating, and then it comes to the oven, and in the oven we'll have a certain compression on the mass, a temperature for curing, and so on, and by that we'll produce these boards, blankets, these mats, what are cutted for the insulation. Or this stuff is milled, and then you have this loose filling, which you all know, probably, or have seen already. Okay. Stone wool production is different, totally different. Stone wool production, you start with a basalt, which you have large deposits of basalt, you know, or diabase or something like that. And you mix it with coke in layer by layer in a so-called cupola furnace. Then you fire it. The carbon will fire, produce CO2 and water, and so, you know, and the glass or the minerals will be melted. So this is really a melting process. The other is just heating up glass, because it are glass colors already. And then you have the melt flow through this outlet here, and then through a cascade rotator. So these are like bones, you know, and they are rotating very fast, and the melt is coming between here and here and here, and they are rotating, so the fibers are going in this direction up to that. So by that they produce the stone wool. Mineral wools, okay. And then you see curing in this type of furnace, and then cutting to have, and here the insulation materials. Okay, totally different process. Raw materials, basalt, diabase, slag, alumina, high alumina content in that. So this is an alumosilicate glass, alkaline earth. Low iron is one of the most important things here, because this will bring our properties down. Okay, so these are the production. Now comes to the properties. The property is a little bit complicated. I put it in two things. You have not to learn. You get all the handouts. You have nothing. I will send to you. One thing we have to learn here. One is the material property. The material specific value is a thermal conductivity or thermal diffusivity. Thermal conductivity is given here. This is the rate of heat flow, Q dot, divided by the temperature difference. And then this is an object of a certain area and thickness. Okay, this is your material constant, this is material properties. Okay. This is measured mostly as thermal diffusivity, heat capacity, and density. So this is the thermal conductivity divided by heat capacity and density. You come to thermal diffusivity. That's what you measure normally with laser flash. Okay, and then comes now the structural value. So the certain structure, certain object has a certain thermal resistance or thermal transmittance. What is The value which is listed at the end is the thermal transmittance. How much energy transmits through a certain structure. So it's like a heat loss. If we have heating up here inside and outside very cold, how much of the energy, watts per square meter and Kelvin temperature difference between inner and outer is going through the wall outside. Or in Brazil, the other way around, outside very hot, here you want to stay cold, you use this energy. Here, the other way around, what is the transmittance from heat from outside to inside? So that's the thing. But this is always the value, an absolute value of the structure, of the object, of your construction thing, of your wall, of your window, of your roof, of your fundament, whatever. Okay, so these are the things. Thermal transmittance is U value, international U value. And of course, for thermal conductivity, material specific value, it's a lambda or kappa or something is that given. Or thermal diffusivity is sometimes given as an alpha, but also kappa and other are used frequently. Okay, so what you have to keep in mind, material specific value, structure specific value. This is like a heat loss from outside inside to inside outside, depending of our conditions. And the other is a property of the material, of a certain material. Okay, how to measure these things? One side, the material people, they use the proper characterize their materials. And so they have for each of these properties a characterization method for measuring the thermal conductivity, like we have seen here, or the thermal diffusivity. We use the, or mostly used is a laser flash apparatus. I don't know if you have someone here in the UFSCar. It's done by this, and a laser pulse is given on one side of your material, and on the other side, you measure the increase of the temperature as a function of time. Okay, and then the temperature comes down again as it cools. So it's a laser pulse, and by that, you measure on the other side. All the lasers coming from down to up, here's your material, and you measure on the other side with an IR sensor the temperature increase as a function of time. And for the half delta T, you can calculate the thermal diffusivity of your material. So that's what is standardized, done to proper characterize your material. Now comes one material with another material with another material with another material together in a structure. Structure called window, structure called wall, roof, fundament, whatever. So there you have to measure in a different way what is the heat loss. Okay, there are two ways to do this, either by thermography. You have an IR camera and you're looking through this house here and you see this house and the difference of clear is this is more insulated. You see all the blue colors here, so that's not, heat is not coming out. And this facade is not insulated. You see a lot of red here, so very, so this facade is not insulated. Okay. Or to measure this more precisely, you have to have multiple temperature measurements on multiple spots inside your structure. Inside, outside, etc., to determine this U value of your construction, of your element, window or door or whatever. Okay? We'll see the next time how that is then the consequence for the windows. When we talk to windows and to architectural classes, these U values beside the total energy transmission, this is a G value, it's the most important for sun protecting glass, for heat protecting glass. And we see what types or what are the fractions the coating brings, the room between the two glass panes brings, and the gas in between the two glass panes, or if this is a vacuum, would be the nicest, but we don't have vacuum windows so far. Okay, but this is the things we will see next time for windows. We are today just with the fibers. But the concept is the same. There you get the U value of your glazing. So the glazing is the frame, is the glass. If this is a double glaze, the inner glass, the outer glass, and the gas in between the two glass panes, things like that, okay? Okay, here, so a house can lose energy or heat through the roof, through the windows, through the walls, and to the ground, okay? In Brazil, you have always to make the arrows in the other direction, because it's outside very hot, inside you want to stay cool, and so the energy which you spend comes here for the machines running also in this room, but it's the same here. Turn the arrows in the direction of the heat flow rate. Okay, good. So thermal insulation market, I found one paragraph or one diagram for Brazil. So, but it is in most countries it's the same. So half of the cake are the mineral fibers, glass wool, stone wool, slack wool, we have learned that today. And the other half of the cake are the organic, the polyethylene foams and things like that. On the other, so half of the total market is a, would you say, a glass market. So there, and you see that in most of the countries in the world, the temperatures are not ambient, that we can stay just with 25 degrees, everything is nice, you know. That are only very rare spots in the world. Mostly it's too hot or too cold. And especially in the big cities, you need a lot of air condition because the city itself heats up. So by that, more air condition is run, and the air condition what's keeping inside cold, getting outside more hot, of course. Now you have a thermal cycle. Outside you're producing more heat. So it's heating up. So this insulation is a very useful way to get down with your energy consumption. Okay, insulation materials now from the property of the material itself. So we have by this lambda, thermal conductivity, and we say a thermal insulation material should have a thermal conductivity lower than 0.1 watt per meter in Kelvin. Okay. 0.1 is 100, and then comes a bracket for the unit, 10 to the power minus 3 watt per meter in Kelvin, because this is the unit given here in this brochure. And you see here's 100, and then we have 90, 80, blah, 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 70, 60, 50. Where here, foam glass, we'll see in a minute. Then we see glass wools, rock wools, polyethylene foams, polystyrene foams, aerogels, down, but just in red, if something is a vacuum material where a lot of vacuum is inside that material, pores which no gases inside, and then so. But this is evacuated insulation. We can skip here a little bit, but you see that these are values making them to a thermal insulation material. So what is the thermal insulation of the glass fiber? What do you think? Why they insulate at all? Is it the glass? What do you think? Okay, so the glass is one part of the story. The air between is a second part of the story. So the mechanisms, how the thermal conduction is done in porous materials or in fibers with a lot of air in between. You have this fiber net total orientation like we have seen, the wools. Then we have gas in between. The gas is air. Okay, then we have heat, of course, which is conducted through the fiber itself, or if it's a porous foam glass, through the walls of the glass, so inside the material, thermal conduction through the glass, of course, or fiber. But then we have also thermal radiation between the walls from one surface of a fiber to the next surface of a fiber, radiation. Okay? And then there is also thermal conduction through the gas. We have, of course, one atmosphere or something of air in between. If that would be vacuum, would be very nice. This part, well, then we can skip, we can neglect if we had vacuum inside. And we see that this part is important then if we talk about glazings, double pane windows, glazings, because there, what is in between the glass panes is important, that this has to be, best would be a vacuum, and then come noble gases, because noble gases are single atom gases. Single atom gases have a longer mean path, a free path value, so they can transfer their energy less efficient than a nitrogen or oxygen molecule. Okay, so they put in noble gases between the glass panes. Okay. Good. Okay, these are the mechanisms. Okay. Okay, last of these products is foam glasses. Foam glasses, this is also a trademark from, I think, Pittsburgh Corning. These are these materials here. They are produced also by recycling glass, so just heat up a glass again. And then they add some forming agents like silicon carbide, or if these are red, these materials, I don't know if there may be some red materials, then it is manganese oxide and or sugar, some organic. In the heat, these materials give up gases, volatiles. Here it is oxygen, here it is CO2. And the trick is now that this is like a cake. You're having the glass cullets mixed with this foaming agent, and then the glass starts above TG to deform and to sinter all these glass particles by viscous forming together. And then inside, at a certain temperature, these foam agents, they start to give up their gas, oxygen, whatever, magnesium, like this guy here, MnO2, in the heat comes to MnO plus O, you know, things like that, or half O2 would be better, okay, like that. And so this is coming in, and now the trick is that the bubbles which are built, which will be the pores in the cold materials, they have not to burst. So they have to have closed bubbles. This is a trick. You need a cellular structure at the end of closed bubbles. So they have not to go too high temperatures, then they have to go down with the temperature already. Otherwise, if you heat up higher and higher, all these bubbles will come out of the glass melt, of course. We don't want that. We want to stay inside. Okay, this is a trick, and this is in the production to get, at the end, gas-filled closed-pore cell structures. Okay, this is closed-pore cell structures. They have certain advantages after cooling. The closed-pore prevents water absorption. This is one of the key things. So you can use this as insulation in the ground. It will not suck water. It gets not wet. So the gas stays inside the glass cells, the pores. Although you build it in the ground, where the groundwater is inside, you know? This is moisture inside. So insulation property is by that, because the water cannot penetrate through that structure, because it's a closed cell structure, So it kept the insulation properties is maintained, is kept, although you're producing in the ground or you use it in the ground, in the soil somewhere. And this is used in here for insulation of some pipes where hot media inside, vapor is going through to heat up houses from a power station where they produce a lot of vapor, things like that. And of course, these glass can take compressive loads, so you can drive on that stuff. It's not because you are compressive, of course, in tensile with something else, but compressive loads can help. So that's one of the things. And most important, and this is one of the reasons for insulation at all, fibers, foam glass, all are glassy products, and they are fire resistant. So that's one of the things. You don't want to have an organic polyethylene foam around your house. If someone heat, it's just like burning everything, you know. So that's fire resistance. This is one of the major advantages of these foam glasses. Okay. If you want to calculate now the thermal transmittance of a structure, you have to have now the certain values of your materials. If you see glass wool here, concrete blocks, inside surface, outside surface, conductivity, thickness divided to conductivity gives you the resistance. You have the resistance of your wells, and now you have to build the sum here, reciprocal, and you get the U wall is about 0.6 watt per square meter in Kelvin, then for the heat loss through this construction. Okay, this is, again, this is the material property. You see glass wool, 0.04, it's a 4D in our, it's here, 4D. Rock wool, glass wool, here, this is the value, okay? Okay, so you see that, how is that? And this calculation we'll see for the windows next time or when we come to architectural glasses, the U values. That's the values where the companies advertise, we have a better U value, we have a better G value, we have blah, blah, blah. And that, but this is always for the structure, for the concentration, for the object, if you want. Okay, that's pretty much the thing of the insulation. Now, if I have time, I don't know what time we'll have. Half a little bit time. Yes, half an hour or something. Okay, now comes a little bit on fibers, on current research on the fibers. You have learned fiber has a high fictive temperature, but fibers have a biofringence. Now we'll talk a little bit about biofringence of fibers and what the scientific people can learn about that, or what is not known, or what is still a matter of debate, where you can make your second PhD thesis or whatever, I don't know. So, okay, this was a cooperation with Yang Zhengyu from Aalborg University. He's a fiber expert. He's, I think, one of the fiber experts of the world. And this was given a couple of years ago in the fiber symposia. So I add a few of these slides here. So well, coming back to this, and I said, if you make a fiber, you change your properties. Of course, this is strength over one of the diameter. Of course, if you reduce the diameter, though here are the tallest fibers, the smallest thickness, and here are the thickest fiber, you increase the strength. This is clear. Because your floor size, you cannot have large floors in a very thin fiber. And by that, the floors which are on the thin fiber are thinner or shorter than in a thick. Okay? That this is a geometric aspect. So always have higher strengths in a fiber than in a big rod of glass. Okay? Distribution of floors with respect to your dimensions. But on the other thing, this you see that the strengths depend on the three factors which are contributing to the total strengths. One is the floor alignment. Okay, if you draw a fiber under certain stress, it's already gone, Then if you think of a bubble which is inside, the bubble will orient and will make something like that and will be parallel to your drawing stress, to your fiber. So it is, if you think of bending your fiber and producing tensile stress and compressive sit, but on the outside you have a tensile stress, then the fiber would be like this and the tensile stress like this, so it's not so acting. It will be much more taking a risk of a breakage if it will be in direction of the tensile stress. Okay, so this is flaw alignment. Then the surface of a fiber, since this is like an action going on with this onion type of and then comes the fiber down. This time you have a fire polished surface. Okay. So the surface is very nice. But, and then comes the next point, where we're talking about the structure is also anisotropic, or you have a frozen in strain towards the direction of your pulling, of your. So the, you can think that the structure is a little bit elongated in this direction as in this direction. Okay, so the fictive temperature, as you want, the contribution in this direction is larger than in this direction, you know, the anisotropy. If the structure becomes anisotrope, we see it if we look to the optical appearance, to the refractive index. So then the refractive index in this direction should be another than in this direction, perpendicular or parallel to the fiber pulling direction. Because in one we have a stretched structure, like a less, so the angles between the silica tetrahedral is a little bit more open, and the others are a little bit more like that. Well, that's what you see. This is a glass which is stretched, and you see this is again with a red one compensator to make it colorful. You get an appearance like a mineral. You have crossed nickels, that means you have polarized light and you have an analyzer. So you have that. Normally if there is no birefringence, everything is black. But if this is a mineral and it's not a cubic mineral, you have like this is, this is not good. We don't see anything here. This is a very nice one. Okay, then this is black, this guy. If you turn it in this position, then this is bright because the refractive index in this direction in parallel to the long dia of this crystal to the N perpendicular is different. Maybe N parallel is larger than N perpendicular. And then you get a blue. This is the additional color that's like here, tensile stress. If you compress it, you go the other way around and you get the yellow. From the, so the, you always see where is the larger refractive index. The larger refractive index is in this direction, and here the larger refractive index is in this direction. Okay? So you are getting this birefringence. Birefringence is showing you that there is a frozen in strain related or not to the structure of the glasses. And that's what is also one part of the strength evolution of fibers if we think of strength versus reciprocal diameter. Okay, so there's now our fibers. We've learned glass wool spinning with cascade or with a rotator. Then there is, of course, no pulling force. Yeah, there we have no force, we have no stress. This is a continuous fiber, continuous filament. Okay, so there is no mechanical effect, we have just a thermal effect. Very harsh quenched, very sharp quenched material, high fictive temperature, but not frozen in under a certain pulling stress. Okay, the other is with the continuous filaments, continuous fibers, the reinforcement fibers, and for that, the only thing is of interest, reinforcement strength. Yes. So there we have a thermal effect. As you see, TF is TG up to 100 K more, 10 to the power 2 quenched. Roughly, all these are, when they are very 8 micrometers, 6 micrometers fibers, around between 10 to the power 5 to 10 to the power 6 Kelvin per second. So that's much. So therefore, they are called hyperquenched. Okay. And we can freeze in the mechanical stress that is done here in this research. So we took a thick fiber as you want, and we make only a part, and we press it, or we elongate it, okay? And we freeze in the material under pulling. And now we take out the temperature, and then you freeze in this strain, and then the material becomes biofrigent. Okay, this is shown here, and the same is like a direct biofrigence. Like we have measuring the viscosity by a rotational viscometer. You have a spindle inside a pot and you turn it, and you're measuring here the torque of your spindle to maintain a certain rotational speed. But now you have to think, you have a window down there from aluminum oxide, and you look through with polarized light. Then you look through the moving glass melt, and the moving glass melt is oriented laminar stream around. So you have a so-called direct flow biofrigence. This has been measured in the 70s for a lot of glasses. Okay, and then the frozen in, as I said, is the same. We heat up the glass, and we stress it, pulling or compressive stress, and then taking out during pulling the temperature, or doing pressing the temperature. And then if we are at room temperature, then we take off the stress. So the glass is frozen in by uniaxial compressive stress or uniaxial tensile stress. Not from all sides, like if you melt the glass in a pressure chamber or in a pressure vessel. Not that case, not a hydrodynamic stress, uniaxial stress. Okay, then you have these glasses and they cut it and you get plates as you see here, and these plates are biofrigent. Okay, you see here what happens. This is the same from above and from the side, but if you tilt it, you see you're getting biofrigent. So the structure, so the volume, whatever has been in some way more strain has to be frozen in one direction, in our pressing direction or in our pulling direction, than in the other. Okay. Okay, now these glasses, and this depends on the composition. This is for disilicates, from lithium disilicate to sodium disilicate to potassium disilicate. We see for the most glasses, we have in compressive yellow, which is the normal specific biofrigence. All glasses have that, but certain glasses, they show blue. And people, this is a matter of debate, this is nucleation. Is this a sign because these lithium disilicate glasses during your compressive, they already nucleate? You know, lithium disilicate glass studied a lot here in the Institute with Edgar, is one of the prominent materials for showing a homogeneous volume nucleation. So this is not clear at all. Why these lithium disilicate structures show as anomalous specific biofrigence or frozen in strain? Okay. Okay. So how much we can freeze in, and you see the frozen in structure, metasilicate structure, though a lot, 50% alkali, 50% silicates. E-glass, we have learned that already, what the E-glass is, a float glass. And you see, under compressive stresses, of course, we can have more forces, so we can freeze in higher values of these anisotropic values. And here are metaphosphates, silicates, silicate, phosphates, boron oxide. And for boron oxide and metaphosphate, we see by wide-angle X-ray scattering, that the phosphate chains, that they are oriented, the structure is oriented. So you orient your chains. It's more a 2D structure in the phosphates classes. You can orient. For the silicates, it's not so clear. There's not a direct evidence that there also this frozen in strain is related to structural anisotropy. That means alignment of some structural units. I will show we have searched a lot, we have not found something. Okay, so if there is, this is also one of the things which is still open, no one can explain a little bit, what is the structural part on this frozen in strain for silicate classes. For the phosphates and the borates is clear. Here are some biofrigerants of the crystals, quartz, corundum, apatite. So you can produce glasses which have the same optical characteristics like minerals, biofrozen in strain, over frozen in biofrigerants. Okay, now there comes the viscosity plot over the specific biofrigerants. This is a biofrigerants, nanometer per millimeter glass slide per megapascal drawing stress. And you see where the glasses or where the fibers are drawn, more or less, we have learned the viscosity 10 to power 3 to 10 or 2.6 to 1.5, somewhere here, will have high values. All that. So the fibers which are drawn in industry, they, if they are quenched under these continuous filament fibers, they have a high sensibility to get biofrigerant. Their structure more or less oriented. For the silicates we don't know, for the phosphates we know. On all other methods are showing that this is very low, and if you go to room temperature something, stress optical coefficient is very low in glass. Of course you can compress a glass at room temperature and see the biofrigerants. Oh, this is at room temperature. Stress optical coefficient is called there. Okay, so then e-glass fibers comes now. So the e-glass fibers were drawn, continuous fibers, and under a certain drawing stress, they are highly quenched, 200K, we have learned that, and now they are frozen, and now we look what happens with these biofrigerants. Okay, the biofrigerants of a single fiber you cannot measure, because the fiber is so thin that the total biofrigerants, because of the thickness, can't not measure. So delta N is approximately 10 to the power minus 5. What you have to do, you have to make a bundle. It's very delicate stuff. You have to align a lot of these fibers. You make a bundle, okay? And this bundle you have to bring in into such a tube of glass of the same refractive index, e-glass tube, and then you have to immerse this in a oil of the same refractive index than the isotrope tube glass. But now you measure over the diameter of that tube because it's packed, it's stuffed with the fibers, all oriented. So by that, you increase virtually the dimension of the or the thickness of the fiber. Very complicated measurements, but you can do that. And then a fiber bundle with 1 millimeter, the thousands of fibers compressed and stuffed together and bring into that rod, and then immersed in the liquid, and then you can measure with a microscope, a so-called Brace-Köhler compensator, and then you measure the biofrigerants, and then you see the biofrigerants in nanometer per millimeter as a function of the drawing stress, or drawing speed, and with the speed you have the stress, and high speed means a short diameter, and you see that with high speed the biofrigerants goes up, the diameter goes down, and we are up to values of 20 nanometers is the optical parse difference per millimeter of this bundle. Okay. And now you can measure, you heat up these bundles, these fibers, and measure again and measure again. At higher temperatures, the glass should relax and biofringence should go away. Now the function is, or the question is, how it goes away. And by that, you see, it's at a certain temperature for half an hour, I think, or 180 minutes, certain temperatures, you see, this is the diameter, the thinnest fiber have the highest biofringence going down. So everything goes down to about zero at about 500 degrees, okay? Fully relaxed for temperatures above 500 degrees. If we are at 300 degrees, it cannot fully relax. So at 300 degrees, the glass fiber relaxes, but not fully. There are some of these energy which is stored here into that, like in this bird. It's always like that. So this is this bird. So Yang Zheng Yu always draw this bird, you know. Though this tail of the bird, this maybe can relax, but not this one here. Okay, if this is the heat capacity again. Okay, that's most important, that we have certain energetical traps in the structure. You can call this configurational potential energy, you know, and one can relax at a certain energy level and others don't. That's what we see here. Okay, so again, this is the same like the fresh fiber. I've talked about this. The fresh fiber looks like that. Then you make the second heat cooling down with 10K, coming up with 10K. Now you have a normalized fiber with 20K per minute, cooling and heating, thermal history. And by that, you see this CP. And then you have this bird, you know, and this is the excess enthalpy here. And so a part of that from the tail to the belly, it's relaxing. Okay, this is a fictive temperature construction. We have talked about that. And this is a partially relaxed, you know, 500 Celsius, 3 hours, you see. Rest is just this here. And by that, the fictive temperature is not here, it's coming up here. So we are going towards TG. Of course, at the end, everything will end at TG at 20K per minute, and we'll all get something with TG, okay? Okay, so this is how this develops. So it's all DC work done on that, and you see how this relax. So we have a relax of the enthalpy, and we have a relaxation of the biofringence. Now we look if these are the same or they're different. This was the idea. Okay, for the biofringence, you have always, if you have relaxation properties, you have to have a relaxation function. We talked about that last time. Again, if this is structural relaxation, we have a Kohlhaus, William Watts, a stretched exponential function to explain structural relaxation in classes. We see here structural relaxation, biofringence, and heat which is coming out, so we can run both of these properties with this kind of relaxation function. Okay, now this is given here, and then at the end you see with a fictive temperature with delta N, the stretched, the exponent, and the half time, the characteristic time scale tau. In minutes. Okay, and this is given here again. You see already delta N and delta H, how this comes down, and you see that this is different. Delta N relaxes first and then relaxes delta H in these glass fibers. Okay, this is different. And we bring this again to a relaxation map last time. Alpha, beta, gamma relaxation. This is again alpha relaxation. We're looking to glass transformation, or we're coming from Deborah numbers, larger one. If this is cold, this is hot, this is the time we give for relaxing. You know that this is, if we're using a dilatometer, we're heating up with 10K per minute. So we give for each temperature a certain seconds of time of relaxing, then we go to the next, and by that we get typical, of course, a glass transformation like that. Okay, so we're coming from here, and passing here, glass transition. Okay, at that temperature, if we're using ultrasonic waves attacking our glass and heating up the glass, we give the glass shorter time because we have ultrasonic frequency of 1000 megahertz. We are about 10^-7 in the time scale, and by that we see the glass transition at much higher temperatures. So you see 500 and here about 950. Okay, this is always, you're going on time domain or going temperature domain. Okay, it's always the same how much time you give to relax the structure at which temperature. And this gives traditionally this curve. It's not a straight line because the activation energies for this alpha to relaxation glass transition, this is long range relaxation. These are a lot of molecules are cooperatively moving, so on, and by that it is a non-Arrhenian dependence. We know that from viscosity, Vogler, Fulcher, Tamman, yes? Okay, so that's this one, okay? This is alpha. But we have learned that below, and we are at 300 Celsius, for our biofringence relaxation, there are different other ways. Again, you see beta and gamma also by ultrasonic measurements. We have seen last time by using DMTA to measure that. This we had also last time. You see these concepts are always the same for different properties. So we have the alpha relaxation, we have beta and gamma. This is a more global relaxation. This is more regional relaxation. This is a local relaxation. This is connected with the movement of sodium, lithium ions inside the structure. So the movement of network of formers. Here we have relaxation around non-bridging oxygens, okay, changing partners, rotating, whatever. And this, of course, is the bridging oxygen opening, closing, and seeing cooperatively and things like that. Okay, so we bring this together. This is a relaxation map. This is viscosity divided by shear modulus. And then we have the beta, well, the gamma. You see, this is at the same temperatures. If you take one of the temperatures, room temperature would be here or wherever, or we are TG here. So this is much shorter, and it is at lower temperatures, okay? Okay, now ELAS fibers measured, on one side viscosity measured, linearized by the Adam-Gibbs equation. That is always good because you have two measurements, viscosity and the heat capacity measurements, so you had a much better fit because you're just fitting a straight line. Normally you have only viscosity, you have to fit Vogler, Fulcher, Tamman, three parameter equation, so one parameter more, so the other is a little bit better, I think, in my opinion. Okay, and then you measured the shear modulus, here it is, of these E-glasses, and by that you get the alpha relaxation, okay, for our relaxation map, which we draw now. And then we brought in all the biofringence and the excess enthalpy value, and you see that the alpha relaxation goes up here, very short, very high times at passing TG to colder temperatures, of course. And then at that temperatures, the viscosity cannot, it's a function of time. No? So that's what is given here, like these measurements from Zipneville or Richer. So if we have in the glass transition range, we are having the glass fiber, glass at one temperature, and then immediately bring it to another temperature and measuring the viscosity. And the viscosity is first here. This is the unrelaxed viscosity, which is different, of course, of the different temperature. This is the Arrhenian part. And then there comes a structural relaxation. Viscosity comes to the equilibrium. That takes a lot of time. That's given here. if you're coming from higher temperatures, you're coming from below, if you're coming from colder temperatures, you're coming from up, and you see this is the equilibrium viscosity. And this first is the so-called isostructural viscosity. The structure has no time to change. Only thing that has changed is the temperature. So everything is a little bit shorter, you know? And by that, viscosity is a bit different. This is the isostructural viscosity. So you see that the entropy relaxation goes with the isostructural, more or less. But the birefringence, something different. Okay, it's decoupled from that. It's not clear at all what it is. You can make research on it. It's not so clear. Okay, here's again, all together, alpha, beta, gamma. This is the birefringence, and this is the one which is the excess entropy which goes with the isostructural viscosity. This is clear alpha. The other is a little bit something else, or a mixture, or something. Other elements in the relaxation, other relaxation modes, we don't know. Okay. Okay. Oops. Last few things is the pressure. So things we have changed, looked on that. If that under this, we have a force. So we have uniaxial pressure. Though the thing is, you know, if there is boron inside a glass, the coordination of the boron changed with the pressure. Okay, from a threefold to a fourfold coordination, triangle to tetrahedral. Okay, this is given here. And so the isostatic pressure, this is known, isostatic pressure experiment, triangle, threefold coordinated boron to fourfold coordinated. Fictive temperature, we know the fibers are highly quenched. It's the other way around. But for fictive temperature, high fictive temperature, promotes threefold coordinated boron. So the question is, can we measure by NMR some properties telling us what is this relaxation? Is there really something to do with the boron configuration? Okay, so these are pressurized glasses, how to pressure. I have not the time to tell you. This is pressure vessels with argon. And you can melt glasses at very high pressures, isostatic. So these are pressurized glasses having a high fictive pressure, if you want. And then you're doing NMR on that, and you see clearly density pressure is going up, and the number of the fourfold coordinated goes up in that. So this is clear with the pressure. You have more fourfold coordinated, and you see also a little bit of fourfold, fivefold coordinate, and sixfold coordinated comes up. You have a shortening of the sodium oxygen bound in the from all side pressurized glasses. Now the question is, our fibers are just pressured from one side, or tensile strengths on it on one side, uniaxial. Can we measure that again? Okay, here are the samples which are made. So they are frozen in like this. This is the axial compressive stress. This is the birefringence, okay? So they were sent to NMR people at Stanford, Jonathan Stebbins, and he made static NMR because he now has to know what is the NMR signal in certain directions. You cannot a magic angle spinning, because then you make a sum of all orientations. Of course, you cancel out that by this, okay? So here we want to have that, but we don't see anything on that. So it's not a shift in the perpendicular and the parallel, perpendicular, parallel, perpendicular. So we couldn't find any, or he couldn't find anything in that. So it's not the silicon, aluminum, sodium, and the boron oriented in some way or measurable by the, of course, NMR just looks to the nearest range order, to the closest neighbors, first shell, maybe second shell. But if there is something which is in the intermediate range order, we don't see it with NMR, or we have to have other methods. Maybe we can ask here the NMR experts at USP to do more measurements on that, if that is interesting. So at the end, birefringence you can produce a lot of biofrigerants in these fibers. They are taking part to the, or it is discussed that they are one part of the strength evolution of fibers, the biofrigerant, the elongated structure, as the floors are elongated, although the structure is elongated, and by that we have a more strength in fiber direction, things like that. And for the e-glass fibers, we have seen that that the HX is more or less with alpha, but for delta, and it's not so clear. It's close, but it's not so clear. We have seen that that there is no evidence of short-range structural changes with the direction, so perpendicular or parallel to the fiber direction. But we see, of course, compaction of the modifier volume, and it's calculated 15%, 50%, so 50% is missing, and the 50% which is missing, it is open for discussion. It's not clear at all if this is something in the intermediate range order, something of the more larger units, how they are connected in some way, but not the short range order. Okay, but that couldn't be measured. So this is open, the question how biofrigerants or how the structural orientations in silicate glasses or borosilicate glasses can contribute to the strength of the fibers. Okay, these are the partners at that research and yeah, references on that. Okay, and the companies which had supported that. Okay, that's it. Thank you very much. Muito obrigado for this watching this lesson. Okay, thank you for attention.